This is Carib Nation, part two of an interview with Dr. W. Andre, a renowned Caribbean historian, currently a judge in the Superior Court of Brampton, Ontario. Dr. Andre has produced many works of Caribbean history and literature under the banner of his own Pontcassia Press, with one Gabriel Christian, happens to be me, and I'm honored to have been with Judge Andre since 1976, when we were frequent users of the research section of the Rosa Public Library, where we first forged our relationship. And we are here to talk about, in part two, Rosie's return to Dominica. I think that's when we both met him. Rosie returned to Dominica in 1976. Talk about that, Judge Andre, and let's go to through that towards the end of Rosie's life, as captured by your biography, your outstanding biography.
Well, Rosie returned in 1976, and he returned at a very crucial moment in Dominica's history. He returned when the authorities had already started to give some thought to the independence of Dominica. Suffice it to say that the administration, the Labour Party administration and government at the time, initially was reluctant to move towards independence. Rosie provided the initial impetus towards that drive, to a point that by June or July 1976, the then Premier of Dominica made a famous speech in which he talked about independence within 1 year. It was difficult to convince the Dominican electorate of the significance of independence. Rosie provided that impetus. Rosie was the driving force behind the move towards independence. He mobilized virtual communities, students, young people. He established a set of workshops called Cadre Number One, the most important being Cadre Number One in Roseau, then led by a young student leader called Gabriel Christian. And suffice it to say that we held meetings, we founded a newspaper called The Vanguard. We studied, or we dabbled in the study, I should say, of Marxist Leninism, socialism. We went out ambassadors and spoke to a number of youth groups, particularly one called the Young Freedom Movement at the time, which was the youth arm of the Dominica Freedom Party, which is represented the main force of conservatism in Dominica and so on.
So Dr. Andre, when Rosie came back to Dominica in 76, we'd had, of course, the Black Power Movement.
Right.
People like William Revere, people like Donald Peters.
Yes.
People like Julian Johnson. You even hear the name Swinburne Lestrade mentioned occasionally. So in the 1970s, you had people like Ronald Green, who had been a U.S. Peace Corps volunteer, who had come back to Dominica, and there was a movement for New Dominica with a library at Canal Lane in Goodwill, where they would hold in the 1970s, before Rosie returned, Black Power demonstrations. People like Desmond Trotter, people like Bernard Dinard, and Neville Graham been involved in that. Glenn Ducrey. I remember young people, even Sam Christian and people like Amor, the Reginald Amor. You had the walkout at the St. Mary's Academy in 1971, I believe, where the students protested the kicking of a student by a white Christian brother. Christian brothers from Iona College in New York ran the St. Mary's Academy, and Brother Estrada, I believe, was the principal, who was a Hispanic American, considered white for all practical purposes. And so you had that ferment in Dominica before Rosie came back. In fact, I used to hear Rosie Douglas as this great hero. He would come back and free us all. Because in 1974, the government had passed the notorious Dred Act, the Prohibited and Undesirable Societies Act, which legislated that you could kill someone wearing dreadlocks on public or private property without any civil or criminal liability. So people were being killed who wore dreadlocks at that time, and Patrick John and the Labour Party still won the election of 75 by 16 seats, but in 76 were really on the ropes. And when Rosie came back and supported independence and Patrick John latched onto that, it was a shot in the arm to the government, because the government had lost a lot of youth power, lost a lot of youth support. So in places like Grand Bay and Portsmouth and in Maho with Francisco Esprit and people like Subas Esprit and the Dublin family and Claxton Thomas and all these people in Grand Bay, people like Jamala Fontaine and Pierre Charles, they came around and came in support of the Popular Independence Committee, of which we were part, and the Dominica Federation of Students, of which we were part, and then you had the involvement of Bernard Wiltshire as well, coming in there to join Rosie in that independence campaign that you became part of.
But bear in mind one thing, even before, long before Rosie actually came back to Dominica in 76, Rosie had been very influential in the genesis of Black power activities in Dominica. After Rosie was convicted, and he sent Sister Natalie Charles and Joey Peltier to Dominica and to other Caribbean islands to sensitize the region about the struggle for Black equality in Canada. And bear in mind that there was a famous demonstration in Roseau in 1971, which culminated in the burning of the Canadian flag in front of the RBC, the Royal Bank of Canada. And there were demonstrations in that year. So that Rosie, and bear in mind that between 71 and 76, Rosie's organizations in Toronto assisted financially, I should indicate, many organizations in the Caribbean, including a few in Dominica, when Desmond Trotter was arrested and charged with the death of John Jirzak. He was arrested in April of 74.
And John Jirzak was an American tourist who was killed outside the Fort John Hotel.
During the carnival in 1974. And Rosie certainly assisted financially, not only financially, but assisted in making persons aware of Dominica's, what appeared to be Dominica's slide into a type of autocratic, into a papadocracy, as I described it in another context.
So Rosie comes back in 76. We are both at the high school, and we are engaged in the independence movement, panel discussions, debates, and pushing a socialist path of development. Is that correct?
Absolutely. So that created the kind of ideological framework and the support for the march towards independence.
Yes.
It is fair to say that, without exaggeration, that other than the Premier Patrick John, other than him having the discussion, the so-called negotiations. I say so-called negotiations because Britain definitely did not show any significant resistance to the march towards independence. Why? Because by all accounts, the islands represented a financial drain on the mother country. But in terms of getting persons on board in support of independence, it is fair to say that Rosie was the single most important political leader at the time who actually made independence happen. John obviously took the accolades for that transition. But in terms of the groundwork, in terms of popularizing the concept of independence, because Rosie's famous position, as you know, the philosophy was, seek ye first the
political kingdom of
independence and all else will follow.
All else will follow.
Because the major ideological view in contrast to that position was that, look, we cannot attain independence under a leader who appears to be hell-bent on becoming an autocrat. Yes. But suffice it to say that Rose's belief system, Rose's view held sway, and that played a significant role in the attainment of independence. Yes. In November, on about November 3rd, 1978.
So you're saying that the political left in Dominica was split. Not all of the political left supported independence under Patrick John. There were those like William Revere and others, like Ron Green, who thought that, again, that drive towards autocracy by John was of concern, as with the Freedom Party. They wanted a referendum. And Rosie's position was referendum first. I mean, it's a referendum, it's secondary referendum, independence first. Everything would follow afterwards. But Rosie did something else to the political position of the left, which had been in that time pretty much a insular left, meaning it had not had much contact with any state power. Rosie linked the political left of Dominica to the Cuban Revolution. Tell us about that.
Well, Rosie again was the father of the historic relationship developed between Cuba and Dominica. And that initiative by Rosie commenced well even before 1976. I mean, it accelerated in 1976 when he formed the Dominica-Cuban Association, when he organized, for example...
You mean the Dominica-Cuba Friendship Society?
Friendship Society.
Founded at a grammar school in 1976.
when he organized a tour of Cuba by some prominent citizens, including people like his own sister, his elder sister, Euphemie, the premier's wife, Desiree John, I believe Alwyn Bully, the central cultural czar at the time, when they visited Cuba, he took the initiative to break that Cold War mentality towards Cuba in Dominica. And that is one of the initiatives he took. That initiative was accelerated when he started. He and we, in conjunction with Bernard Wilshire, in the aftermath of Hurricane David in 79, they jointly organized for Dominican students to study in Cuba. And after that initial initiative, suffice it to say that thousands, it is fair to say that thousands of Dominican students have studied and have become professionals through that initiative in terms of breaking that ice, that icy relationship, that Cold War relationship between the West and Cuba.
As a matter of fact, I would say that Fidel Castro had a very warm relationship with Rosie, because Rosie represented that phenomena, the British West Indian leaders, Forbes Burnham, Guyana, Errol Barrow, Barbados, Michael Manley, Jamaica, Eric Williams, Trinidad, who were primarily members of the West Indian Student Union, again, who were the first to break the blockade, because with the exception of Mexico and Canada, all of the Americas had broken relations with Cuba at the instigation of the United States. And for these small tourism-dependent islands, to a great extent, to have taken that leadership role and to have broken that blockade and established relations. And then Rosie encouraging the Eastern Caribbean Islands, which were still associated states of Britain, to begin those links with Cuba. That was really revolutionary at the time. As a matter of fact, I remember it was at that time we started getting English language copies.
Of the grandma.
Of the grandma. I remember my father saying to me, you know, you're bringing grandma here all the time. Where's grandpa? You know, where's grandpa? In a very humorous way. But our parents had to contend with that. So Dominica becomes independent in 1978. Before that, there's Ray John, Tingale, McIntyre, Alwyn Bully. They've been to Cuba. In fact, Alwyn Bully comes back and designs the flag and puts a red orb in the center of the flag, which stands for socialism. So the Dominica flag as it stands today has a direct correlationship between the trip to Cuba taken by Alwyn Bully under the auspices of the Dominica Cuba Friendship Society and the design which evolved from that, which had a socialist emblem of red, the color red, at the center of the Dominican flag. So independence is attained, but within 6 months, Patrick John is gone. Tell us about the role of Rosie Douglas in the transition from Patrick John after the May 29th riot or insurrection and the interim government.
Well, as you know, Patrick John faced a Waterloo of sorts in May of 79. Suffice it to say that after the Defense Force fired on unarmed citizens protesting the impending enactment of legislation designed to curb press freedom and designed to curb freedom of association in terms of unions, mass rioting and precipitated by joint efforts of all opposition forces, including Rosie, led into the systematic resignation of ministers of government. They did so under duress, under the threat of being accosted with stones and so on. And Rosie was the one who came up with the idea of a committee of national salvation, that is to say, a committee that encompassed the disparate political forces and commercial interests and church leaders and so on into one united organization, which would be the shepherd, the good shepherd, which would ensure that Dominica didn't slide into anarchy and Dominica embarked on a road of legitimacy.
That's very important because, you know, Judge Andrew is a man who's a rule of law oriented. We must say that Rosie started in agriculture, but by the time he moved on to support and McGill, had studied political science. And Rosie was very much about education. I mean, he had the cadre we were part of, go through Robert's Rules of Order. You had to keep minutes, pass a motion, second the motion, review the minutes and so on, and prepare papers, position papers. Rosie was the first person I knew in the political realm to say that before you go to a meeting, you have to have the meeting before the meeting. the meeting before the meeting is the most important meeting. So when you went into the meeting, you had a position that you would take, and you'd have people ask questions, all of you in the room, but still linked together so you could guide the meeting into a particular direction. He was the first to bring the youth together in 77 to elect Pierre Charles, the students and the youth, as president of the National Youth Council. So with that kind of training, Rosie not only was the one who came up with the idea of a committee of national salvation to bring the uprising to soft landing, because it was what was negotiated through the constitution, that is the government leaders on the Labour Party side, withdrew their support from Patrick John. Through the Committee of National Salvation, they put that behind O.J. Serafin in Parliament, and he became Prime Minister. So there was no need for a constitution to be abandoned, and the role of Eugenia Charles, the trade unions, and the others must be considered. But he also did another thing, and that is the left was divided between the Popular Independence Committee, led by Rosie Douglas, and the People's Democratic Party, led by William Parra Rivera, and the Democratic Alliance, led by Mike Douglas, who had been fired from the Labour Party and was then in Parliament. Rosie brought the left together under the Dominica Liberation Movement, DLM.
Yes, he did. He did. And that is, there's some controversy in terms of Rosie's choices at the time, because Rosie aligned himself with remnants of the Dominica Labour Party, then led by Oliver Serafin. Mike Douglas, his brother, was also a member of Oliver Serafin's movement. And that created a lot of negativity with the other members of the liberation movement who coalesced under the banner of the Dominica Liberation Movement. Suffice it to say, the elections were fought. Suffice it to say, in the interest of time, the elections were lost. Rosie was somewhat in a political wilderness. Eugenia Charles emerged triumphant. There's a famous cartoon of Eugenia Charles standing successful and victorious over a twin-headed dragon, that twin-headed dragon being the DLM and the party of then led by Oliver Serafin. If I may just fast forward, Rosie gravitated, as you indicated earlier, to becoming the key player in the Mataba.
I go to the Mataba and African Liberation, I think it's important to just give a brief note here to our listening audience of the important role Rosie played in bringing along Algie Mathie, who disclosed the Operation Red Dog plot to invade Dominica in 1981, and disclosed that to Mike Douglas, Hilaire Ndeja, myself, to disclose that plot to Eugenia Charles in a way to make sure that it did not succeed, and that Algie Mathie, who had been with Rosie in Montreal as his bodyguard, and who was a Black Power activist himself and a Rastafarian, to make sure that the Klan did not come in and occupy Dominica. That's the American Nazi Party and the Ku Klux Klan. And Rosie played a role in basically disclosing that plot, which led to the dissembling of the plot.
Yes, absolutely. What happened, as you know, and without going into the details, this attempt to invade Dominica by the dogs of the earth, or the wretched of the earth, whatever you don't call them. And suffice it to say that Mike, Rosie's brother, as you know, got word of it. Disclosed it to Rosie.
Algie Mathie, yes.
Rosie then disclosed it to Mike, his brother. And Mike then disclosed it to Eugenia Charles. And that is how it came about that Eugenia Charles was forewarned about what was in store for her. And she initiated the process of arresting many of those implicated in the attempted coup.
That's right. Patrick John, Rosie is the one Joseph.
Who disclosed exactly what was in store for Dominica.
Yes.
And obviously, the rest is history. The plotters were arrested. There was a subsequent attempt to overthrow Charles. Suffice it to say that there was a trial. John was convicted on or about 1985. Of the attempt to overthrow a legally elected government, sentenced to a number of years. He was eventually released, as you know, in 1990 by Eugenia Charles. 1 day or 2 days, I think it's 1 day after she almost lost the 1990 elections.
Yes.
Yeah, obviously released him as a cynical political move to gain some of the support which John still enjoyed.
Yes.
Among the electorate, because bear in mind, that even before his conviction, John had won in 1985 a seat in the St. Joseph constituency. Rosie also won for the first time in the Peebush against a prominent lawyer, General Moore. Yes. Rosie would go on to lose in 1990. But Eugenia released John in 1990, a day or two after she almost lost the 1990 general election.
So Rosie's out of the political limelight insofar as being involved in government. He moves to Libya and becomes a leader, the executive director of World Mataba, that's now supplying arms and material to the African National Congress, Umkhonto we Sizwe, guerrilla army, as well as the People's Liberation Army of Namibia, led by the Southwest African People's Organization, SWAPO. Tell us about that period and his return to Dominica as prime minister.
Yeah, so basically, Rosie played a tremendous role in the advancement of liberation struggles, not only in Africa, but in the support of progressive forces in the Eastern Caribbean. Rosie arranged for many of our Caribbean leaders, George Odlum, Tim Hector, Ralph Gonzalez, and others, many Dominican leaders, Alfie in Montreal, to attend Libya on a number of occasions, even arranging for his son Robert Nautiani Bianzin to do the same. And Rosie secured funding for many organizations, not only in the Caribbean, not only in South Africa, but also in England. The famous Bernie Grant is one name which comes to mind. Rosie established a very close relation with the Nation of Islam led by Farrakhan. And in fact, as you know, he also appointed in 2000, Agba Mohammed, if my memory serves me right.
Yes, Agba Mohammed.
Diplomat at large, and in terms of his movement.
So Rosie brought Martin Luther King III to Dominica in April of 2000, when he was for the first Martin Luther King Day.
That's right, and
in the Caribbean.
But as you know, that was part of Rosie's vision. Rosie's vision was to make Dominica somewhat of a mecca for African in the diaspora, particularly African Americans. So he assiduously cultivated a relationship with African American leaders. And as you've alluded to, Rosie invited Martin King III, Jr., Martin King Jr. III, to Dominica when he was sworn in as Dominica's prime minister. And Rosie, as you know, again, without going into details, brought a couple of rappers from America, a couple of musicians from Louisiana. So that was part of his overall vision to expose Dominica into that untapped market, to have
So Dominica will be the new mecca of the African liberation struggle in way of violent struggle now because independence has been attained, but a mecca and also an Athens. And so he began crafting partnerships with universities. The first being the University of New Orleans in New Orleans, Louisiana, which he did in March of 2000. Then he had other partnerships that he had planned with Middlesex in the United Kingdom for computer technology and York University in Canada, as well as McGill, his former alma mater. Tell us about Rosie's focus on education as part of his legacy.
Well, it was very integral to his legacy. Rosie envisioned Dominica being pushed, jumping and screaming into the 21st century. Rosie envisioned Dominica being a central hub where technological innovation persons would meet almost on hallowed ground in Dominica. Many universities would have bases in Dominica, would have educational institutions. Dominica would be ushered into the technological age, the world of the internet, the world of innovation in education, the world of major conferences, major meetings of intellectuals. Dominica would become that type of paradise, intellectual educational paradise.
And Dr. Andre, I know your time is short. Rosie came in February of 2000, goes to University of New Orleans. He's got a coalition government with the Freedom Party, which had been his nemesis prior, but now the left and right have come together. in coalition with the United Workers Party in opposition, and he travels the diaspora. He's trying to now bring the African-American diaspora together with the African diaspora and the Caribbean diaspora, one package, and is to speak on October 16th at the Million Family March in Washington, where he's going to make a major declaration.
Yes, Rosie envisioned a public declaration granting honorary citizenship to all African Americans. And again, that was part of his vision. Just as his vision of having a closer relationship with Europe, given Dominica's proximity to Guadeloupe and Martinique. So all that was part of an overarching vision, which would place Dominica almost at the hub. And that was very daring for him to think so. Dominica is 300 square miles, if you're being generous, a population of 17. And Rosie is out there seeking to attract persons from major centers, population centers, major countries to focus on Dominica as a hub, either for recreational purposes or for educational purposes, investment purposes, and so on.
Or ecotourism purposes.
Right.
Ecotourism purposes. And so the most important thing, therefore, is October 1st, 2000.
October 1st, 2000.
Rosie
well, actually, make it September.
Days.
Rosie died within a day of returning from a four-week trip abroad. And suffice it to say, there was an avalanche, a literal avalanche of suffering and grief. And again, I tried to describe it in as minute detail as I could. Rosie's death was a significant and profound tragedy for Dominica, for the Caribbean, for the rest of the progressive world, and for the cause of Pan-Africanism. And again, I detailed the number of leaders from all over the world who congregated and convened on Dominica to attend and to show their great respect for the vision of Rosie Douglas, the paroxysms of grief, the sorrow, the lamentations, the eulogy of Team Hector, the compliments, the condolences expressed by world leaders from all over, including Jean Chrétien, then the Canadian Prime Minister, leaders from England, from Europe, Guadeloupe and France.
The Cuban Vice President, of course.
Absolutely unprecedented in the annals of Dominican history.
I believe sadly, the record is that 120 countries were represented.
Oh, absolutely.
Either by government officials or by non-government organizations. I remember meeting the representatives of the Sinn Féin, the Irish Republican Army, the FMLN, WAPO, ANC, it was just unbelievable that Rosie had left us on the mountaintop. What is his legacy? What will your book speak of when it speaks to his legacy on Dominica?
Well, sadly and unfortunately, the book will detail the extent to which what Rosie envisioned in terms of Dominica's future has been compromised to a significant degree. His policy towards the African diaspora, his policy with respect to a closer association, his policy towards the indigenization of Dominican industry, his policy towards improving the lot or empowering the indigenous community in Dominica, his policy of good governance, his policy of repatriating Dominican citizenship, his policy of restoring dignity to the exclusive honor of being a Dominican. Unfortunately, all those policies have been compromised to a significant degree.
So you're saying that this wholesale sale of our citizenship, the different scandals with different criminal elements being arrested as Dominican diplomats, the building of palaces, the lack of a relationship with the African diaspora and the African-American diaspora, and the linkages that Rosie had forged in development process. Are you saying that those have not been made manifest in those who came after him, with the exception of Pierre Charles?
Oh, absolutely. And that is the biggest tragedy in terms of Rosie's legacy, that many of his acolytes did not pay sufficient adherence to them. And the biggest loser has been Dominica.
Indeed.
But again, given the work of a number of patriotic Dominicans, and that's probably be the note on which I end, people like yourself, people in the States, people in Dominica itself, people in other parts of the world, still adhere to the noble vision of Rosie and the vision of Dominica taking its proud place in the community of nations that adhere to the rule of law and that seek to advance the lot of their people. So that is the future for Dominica. The future of Dominica rests in the hands of patriots like yourself and others who envision a day when the name of Dominica will induce smiles on the faces of everyone who hears that name.
Dr. Andre, I cannot but thank you on behalf of all those who are members of the Popular Independence Committee or who played some part in the Black Consciousness Movement, not only in Dominica, but across the Caribbean and across Africa and the African diaspora, the United States and Canada, for your majestic effort in this instance and over the years, so that we can continue to live lives that's dedicated not to only ourselves, our families, our professional stature, self-aggrandizement, but really dedicated to the common good and the commonwealth.